Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. This morning we come to a passage that could easily be made into two separate sermons. In fact, most people think that the things described in this morning's passage are definitely two separate services. It tells us of two people who are in two very different and very disparate situations and journeys. And it tells us of how Jesus miraculously met their needs. There are many lessons that we can learn from either of these two incidents all on their own. But I believe that they were meant by God to be put together. I believe that God has so interwoven these two events that they together emphasize one great principle to us of how Jesus works faith into our lives. Let's begin by reading these two stories as they've been presented to us in Matthew's gospel. Jesus had been given the words of instruction to the disciples of John the Baptist, along with the Pharisees listening in about himself and the principles of the kingdom he was establishing. And then we read, while he spoke these things to them, behold, a ruler came and worshiped him, saying, my daughter is very sick. My daughter is going to die. But come and lay your hand on her, and she will live. So Jesus arose and followed him, and so did his disciples. And suddenly, a woman who had a flow of blood for 12 years came from behind and touched the hem of his garment. For she said to herself, if only I may touch his garment, I shall be made well. But Jesus turned around, and when he saw her, he said, be of good cheer, daughter. Your faith has made you well. And the woman was well from that hour on. When Jesus came to the ruler's house and saw the flute players and the noisy crowd wailing, he said to them, make room for the girl. She's not dead, but sleeping. And they ridiculed him. They knew a dead person when they saw him. But when the crowd was put outside, he went in and took her by the hand, and the girl arose. And this report went out throughout the land. Two seemingly very different stories are being told to us in these verses. They both involve females, one a young girl, and the other a grown woman. And yet, if you think about it carefully, what Matthew is saying, you'll see that there are some remarkable similarities between the two stories. Aside from the fact that both stories are about females, we see that they are both called daughters. That word is one that has an affectionate feel to it. And so the man tells Jesus, my daughter has died. And Jesus tells the woman, who is older, be of good cheer, daughter. We read in Mark and Luke, telling the same story, that this poor girl was only 12 years old. But we read that the woman had her ailment for 12 years. In other words, she suffered her affliction for as long as the young girl had been alive. Both stories involve sickness, and both sufferers were there, so to speak, at the end of their rope. And that's a phrase that you've heard people use. I am at the end of my rope. Especially parents, sometimes their kids put them at the end of their rope. And I'm sure that many of you here can relate to that. Mark tells us when the man came to Jesus, he said, "My little daughter lies at the point of death." And similarly, Mark also tells us that this woman had suffered and had gone to many physicians. She had spent all that she had had at the doctors, but was no better. In fact, she was worse. But both stories involve severe suffering. Both stories also give us examples of deep faith. The situation of a change when Jesus came into the picture. Jesus had great mercy on both, and in both cases, Jesus healed as a result of a touch. This morning, I'd like us to look at the two stories in greater detail, and I hope that we can draw out just some of the many similarities and lessons that they have to teach us. But the thing to notice is not so much what we learn from them separately, but what we learn from them together. The Holy Spirit has chosen to weave these two stories into one. So that's a very important lesson that can be taught to us. Let's look at it a little closer. The first thing we have to notice is a great need, and it was presented to Jesus. Jesus had been speaking to the disciples about John the Baptist, and Matthew tells us while he spoke to them, his conversation with them was interrupted. A ruler came to him with a state of urgency, great urgency. Who was this ruler? Well, the gospel tells us that his name was Jairus, and that he was very important and very responsible man. He was the ruler of the synagogue, which is where the Jews had worshiped. The synagogue, of course, was an important religious institution. And the ruler of the synagogue was the man who had been chosen by their elders to oversee the entire operation of the synagogue. He did several things. He saw to the upkeep of the building. He supervised in times of worship. He was responsible to choose a man or men to read the scriptures or to pray or to give instruction to the various people. There's an interesting story in the Gospel of Luke that gives us some insight into the role of the ruler of the synagogue. Jesus had healed a crippled woman in the synagogue during the Sabbath. And immediately the woman began to glorify God. But the ruler of the synagogue was very angry that Jesus had healed on the Sabbath. This was very irregular, and he felt that things needed to be brought into an order. So he stood up and said to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which men ought to work. Therefore, come and be healed on those days and not on the Sabbath day." It was, of course, a silly thing for him to say, and Jesus proved him to be somewhat hypocritical. But this at least shows us how important a man that ruled the synagogue was. It was his job to make sure that things were done in a certain order, according to the teachings of the scriptures. And that makes it even more remarkable that this ruler, Jairus, came to Jesus in a way that he did. Luke tells us that he fell down at Jesus' feet and begged him to come to his house. For this ruler of the synagogue to bow down to Jesus and pay homage to him in this way was a tremendous, tremendous testimony to what he believed about Jesus. Clearly, he had heard the things that Jesus had been doing, and this was his act of homage. Jesus now indicated the kind of conclusion he came to, confirming the things that he had heard. What was it that Jairus wanted so desperately for Jesus to do? He was pleading earnestly, sincerely with Jesus to come to his home and just lay his hand on his daughter. He said, "My daughter has just died, but come and lay your hand, and she will live." Think of that. What a thing for a faithful servant, a faithful Jewish leader, to say. He could only say such a thing because he believed the many things that he had been hearing about Jesus. This man Jesus was so precious, and that he was truly the Son of God. Now just consider the faith in Jesus. He said, "But come and lay your hands on her and she will live." Where would he have gotten such an idea? Where would such a conviction come from? I believe that he had been hearing all the different miracles that Jesus had performed at that time. I believe that Jairus had heard that Jesus had reached his hand out and touched the leper that we read about earlier in the books of Matthew, and how the man's leprosy was immediately cleansed. And it may be that he also heard that the healing of Peter's mother-in-law, who was very sick and had been running a very high fever, and Jesus touched her and the fever was gone. He was convinced that if Jesus would come and lay his hand on his dying daughter, she too would live. And look at the great mercy of our Savior. He never turns away anyone who comes to him with such faith. Matthew tells us, "So Jesus arose and followed him, and so did his disciples." We are told also that a great crowd also followed along with him. So there would have been a lot of witnesses to this particular miracle. So Jesus goes with the man to save his daughter and to meet the great need. But as so often happens in life, something else happens, and one story leads to another. In accordance with his plan for good, these two stories intersect. And thus we see that the faith-building event occurred first before that need was met. Now put yourself in Jairus' shoes for a moment. He was a desperate father, and some of you here are fathers, so you can relate to the concept of urgency. Without a doubt, he trusted Jesus to be able to save his daughter from death, but he wanted Jesus to get to the house as quickly as possible. Death totally took his daughter away. There wasn't a moment to lose. And so you can just imagine how frustrated he must have been as Jesus stopped to meet the needs of another woman who sought him. I'm sure that if he had a watch, he would have been checking the time very nervously, saying, "What's happening here?" But let's turn for a moment from Jairus' situation and consider this poor woman. Her situation was very desperate as well. She had been suffering for 12 years, and that certainly would have taken a toll on her physically, emotionally, and mentally. I suspect that she would have been drained and very sickly. I even wonder if that's why she reached out and touched the hem of the Savior's garment. Perhaps she had become too weak and couldn't reach any higher. Perhaps her situation had even come to a point of being grave. Her illness also took a toll on her financially. She apparently had some financial means when her illness began, but her money was eventually drained away. She had spent everything she had on her whole livelihood, on physicians, and none of them were able to help her. In fact, she seemed to get sicker and sicker and poorer and poorer. Some of us here today have suffered from illnesses like that, where we've tried to find answers to what's wrong with us, but the doctors could tell us nothing. In such cases, you're willing to try anything, traditional medicine, homeopathic medicine, any kind of care we can get. And yet nothing seemed to work. The doctors don't know what's wrong with you, and yet the medical expenses keep coming in. In a horribly frustrating and scary situation, this is one that we want to try to avoid. And what's more, this woman's illness took a toll on her in other ways. We're not told what the nature of the bleeding was. But if it was very private nature, it would have been considered ceremonially, she would be considered ceremonially unclean. In which case, she would have been ostracized. She would have been set apart from society. Anyone that she touched would have been considered unclean. Everything that she had laid her hand on or sat on would be considered to be defiled. And whoever touched those things afterwards would also be considered unclean. So she would have been an outcast, unable to enjoy the various cultural and religious things that people enjoyed at that time. Imagine being in that condition for 12 years. There's a sense in which she and Jairus and something had something in common. They had come to the end of their resources. They had nowhere else to go but to Jesus and to hope for his mercy. But as the old hymn goes, and it is a very old hymn, when we have exhausted our store of endurance, when our strength has failed ere the day is half done, when we reach the end of our hoarded resources, our Father's full giving has only just begun. She, like Jairus, had heard about Jesus and having no other hope, she sought him out as he made his way to Jairus' house. My guess is that because of her condition, she didn't dare try to meet him publicly in any sort of manner. She wasn't sure how people would have reacted to this, of her trying to touch Jesus. But look at what Matthew tells us about her faith in him. For she said to herself, if I could only touch his garment, I shall be made well. Perhaps she didn't dare to think of touching Jesus himself or asking him to touch her, but she felt really sure that if she could just touch his garment, it would be enough. And so, driven as she was by her faith in Jesus' power to heal, she crept up behind him and reached out and touched the hem as he passed by. Now, how many times have you and I been bumped in a crowd? You don't know. Sometimes you even end up with bruises and you say, I wonder where I got that from. And this was a large crowd of people pressing in on him from all different sides. But as someone, he said, Jesus knows the difference between a press and a touch. This was a touch that came from faith. And he always notices those who have faith in him. I believe that this should be a great encouragement to all of us as we are here today. We may not be able to physically reach out and touch him like this woman did, but we can reach out and touch him with our prayers and with our faith. And when we do this in sincere faith, he always notices. Look at how he noticed her. Matthew tells us that Jesus simply turned around and saw her. But in the book of Mark, it says even more. He says that as soon as the woman touched him, the fountain of blood was dried up, and she felt her body had been healed of this affliction. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that power had gone out of him, turned around to the crowd and said, who touched my clothes? But his disciples said to her, you see the multitude of people thronging in at you, and you say, who touched me? And he looked around to see her who had done the thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell down before him and told the whole truth. Why do you suppose she was so afraid? Why did she feel the need to confess? I suspect that it was because she was an unclean woman, and she felt that once she was found out that maybe she had stolen a healing, she would have to give it back. But look how tenderly Jesus talked to her and speaks to her. He says, "Be of good cheer, daughter. Your faith has made me well." And let's be careful to note the details. He calls her daughter, which is a definite term of endearment. It's a word that can be referred to a young woman, and perhaps she was still relatively young, though she had suffered for 12 years. He tells her to be of good cheer, which certainly speaks to the fact that she was without hope, desperate, and very afraid. In fact, the words he used may have given us the idea that she was no longer an outcast among her people and that her uncleanliness had been taken from her. And he told her that she may not have fully understood at first that it was her faith, not her touch, that had made her well. Perhaps she thought that it had something to do with touching his garment. But he lets her know that it was really a matter of the faith that she sought. The touch was just an expression of that faith in him. And it was he himself that had healed her. And before we depart from this woman, let's make one more observation. The words that Jesus used can literally be translated, "Be of courage, good courage, daughter. Your faith has saved you." Now, the Bible is written in many languages and has been translated, and sometimes we use the King James Version, we use the New Version, but they all have been translated, and sometimes translations have different words, just a little essence. And so this is what some of the Bibles will say: you have been saved. Could it be that he also saved her soul in the process? Well, consider that she had faith that he could heal her. And this couldn't have been before any other reason than before she had heard that many of the reports on him were true. Surely the reports she had heard about him would have been confirmed to her. And what he had said, that he was the Son of God, walking upon the earth in human flesh. And what's more, and we plainly see this, her story had become an honor part of the story of the gospel. And it actually is recorded in 3 of the 4 gospels. So she must have been able to tell her story to many of God's people for it to become recorded in this fashion. Jesus' words to this poor woman, as they are found in the original language, are words of gospel encouragement. They are words that every sinner who truly comes to an end for himself or herself and who reaches out to Jesus in faith can take to heart. Be of good courage. Your faith has saved you. What words of encouragement they must have been to the poor woman. What words of encouragement they ought to be to us. What words of encouragement they should be to the world. But while Jesus was caring for this woman, Jairus was impatient because his daughter was dying and precious time was just slipping away. "Your daughter is not dead." People had come and they had said that your daughter is dead. "Why trouble the teacher?" And he said, "No." But notice what Jesus does. As soon as Jesus heard the words that were spoken, he said to the ruler, "Don't be afraid, only believe." only believe. And why would Jesus encourage Jairus to believe? It was because of what Jairus had just seen. He had just seen this other woman healed. He had just seen a woman who had been sick for the same number of years that his daughter was alive, had been healed. He had performed many miracles of healing before this time. And now, before Jairus' own eyes, he had performed yet another. And now Jesus encouraged him not to be afraid of what he had just heard, but to believe in the one with whom he had just seen. I have no doubt that Jairus did believe, because on to the house he went. And I hope you see the point. Jesus had just performed a faith-building act before Jairus, before his unique concern was to be met. And now, as a result, Jesus met the need in an even greater way than was expected. You see that this seemingly interruption in the mission that Jairus had and the delay it caused was a key part in God's big plan for everything. It was Jesus' intention not only to meet the need of the poor woman, but to do it right in front of Jairus and all of the others, to encourage his faith in Jesus for an even greater challenge than at first he first thought. Now he was going with Jesus, and Jesus was not to simply heal his daughter, but even raise her from the dead. They finally made their way to the house. Already the mourners were there. Professional mourners were often used, and I know that for some of us this is hard to comprehend, but they would have professional mourners come, and they would play flutes and very somber music, and there would be mournful wailing. And even the poor people within the area would have these professional mourners. And for Jairus, who was so important, there were many, many people there already. And when Jesus saw this, he did something remarkable. When Jesus came to the ruler's house and saw the flute players and the noisy crowd waiting, he said to them, "Make room, for the girl is not dead, but sleeping." Now clearly the girl was dead, but Jesus said she was not dead and that she was only sleeping. The girl had died, but Jesus said she was sleeping because that's how our Savior sees death. He's about to raise her up. Do you remember when he was going to raise his friend Lazarus from the dead? He told his disciple, "Our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I may wake him up." His disciples misunderstood. They said, "Lord, if he sleeps, he'll get well." He had to explain to them plainly, Lazarus is dead. But then he went to the tomb to raise him up. In raising up Lazarus, Jesus proved that he was the resurrection and the life. And now he was about to do so in the case of Jairus' daughter as well. It's ironic what happened after he said those words. The mourners laughed. The word that Matthew used was that they laughed Jesus down, they mocked him, and they ridiculed him. "Not dead," they scoffed, "only sleeping? Yeah, really. How can anyone be so foolish?" They switched from mournful wailing and weeping to insulting laughter and scorn. And instead, this always was a response of unbelief to the Savior's power. They weren't laughing for long, though. And they weren't mourning for long, either. I love how Jesus brought funerals to a screeching halt. Now, if I may put it this way, Jesus demonstrates class. He doesn't look at all these people who are mocking him and then tell them to follow him to the girl's room. and watch what he does, and then they'd all see something that would shut up their mocking mouths. No, Jesus wasn't that way. He doesn't put on a show for unbelievers. Instead, he protects the girl's dignity. He put all the mourners outside. I'm sure they weren't very happy about this. It may have been that they were left ungraciously, but the word that they use is that he was cast out. Cast out the scoffers, and contention will leave. Mourners weren't needed around anyway, now that the Lord was present. Then Matthew tells us what happened in a very simple terms. But when the crowd was put outside, he went in and he took her by the hand and the girl arose. Matthew almost says it was like no effort for him at all. All it took was a touch from the master's hand and her life was restored to her. So here are two stories that have been deliberately woven together into one for us. And there are many great spiritual lessons that are meant to be taught about Jesus. But once again, let's remind us the practical lesson that was meant to be. God may stop us and show us something that he does in life. And he may show it to us in the life of another person. He may give us what some call a wonder on the way, in order to strengthen our faith for something even greater than we expected. His ways are interwoven. What he does for you is meant to teach me. What he does for me is meant to teach you. And how do we apply this? We do so by paying attention to what Jesus is doing in each other's lives. And we listen to rejoice together in the things that God does for each other. We should joyfully testify to one another of the love that God has done and the things that he has done for us, and thus be used by him to build up one another's faith in himself. And I believe that this is mentioned in Corinthians as well. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, let's remember that when God takes us through a trial or a difficulty, it's to show us his own glory in and through us. And let's also remember that we ourselves may not be the only one that this trial is meant to teach. In fact, we may not even be the primary one that the lesson is intended for. We are being watched by one another, and perhaps our trial is meant to be the encouragement and to uplift someone else's faith. Let's allow him to make us faith lessons to one another. Let us pray. Lord, we ask in Jesus' name, we need faith and hope. We want to live by faith and not rely only on our own understanding. Grant us the faith and hope to go on, to believe you and your word in every situation of our lives. Teach us to rely on your word and be the blessing to others. This we ask in your name. Amen.